for more on this story. We bring in NHL Network insider Elliotte Friedman. Elliotte, there's so many ways we could go in this conversation. I'll just start with this. We've now gone through three head coaches in Buffalo in about 5.5 seasons. How crucial is it that the next coach is a little more permanent and sticks around a little longer? Because it seems like the lack of stability is a big part of the problem here.
Jackie, I think that's a huge problem. Stability is so important. You have to make sure that you do this and you do this right. And I think that's exactly what Kevin Adams said, is that they're going to take their time. They're not going to rush to do this. And I think what's going to happen is they're going to wait until the end of the season and they're going to see what they decide, see who's available and where they decide to go from that direction. I think the other thing, though, it does sound like one of the things I've been most concerned about the Sabres is that Kevin Adams doesn't have enough help. I think he's got, from what I can tell, he is mapping out right now their future. This is our future if Jack Eichel is a Sabre. This is our future if Jack Eichel is not a Sabre. But the thing is, in order to do that right, you may get more draft picks. You might have to find more players and offbeat paths. They don't have enough staff. And I think they're going to address that too. They got permission today to talk to Jason Carmanos, formerly of Pittsburgh, as his assistant general manager. Those conversations, I think, are going to happen pretty soon. I think you're going to see the Sabres not only change the way they look at their coaching, but I think they're going to change their entire organization in terms of adding people, and I think they need to do it.
Elliotte, I want to ask you in terms of, like, you know, you say that they need more help. I mean, what's been the wait? I mean, I know that we've been in a pandemic. I know things have shut down, but I also know that they made these changes to their management group, you know, what, 10 months ago now, nine months ago? I mean, shouldn't they have had an assistant general manager or some other management type people in place to be helping Kevin Adams before finding out about it now?
Yeah, I would agree with that, EJ. I think they've been slow to do it. I mean, there's no question that, you know, pandemic economics play a big part of that. And I'm not discounting that as a factor. But I think when you're making critical decisions for the future of your franchise, I mean, EJ, you've worked on the scouting staff of an organization. You know how important it is to get into a room with lots of people and hammer it out and come to a consensus, and nobody should ever be scared of different opinions. I think that's been lacking, and I think they're going to address that because this draft is going to be huge for them, and finding players is going to be huge for them.
Elliotte, I'm going to switch gears a little bit and ask you about the New York Islanders, Anders Lee, officially out for the season, their captain and top goal scorer, really, with Brock Nelson. What direction do they go? Are they going to be looking at the trade market? Anybody in particular that would come to your mind?
Well, first of all, Ken, it strikes me as very odd that a lifetime devil would care about the Islanders. Like, this is very strange for me to hear you.
My man Lou Lamoriello is there. Come on.
That
I was with them there a long time, and he's got to have something up his sleeve. I want to know what you think.
I understand that. I understand that totally. Yes. You know, first of all, too bad for Anders Lee, because he's a heck of a player and a big part of that team. And I think the Islanders' identity as their team and taking him out of it is a huge loss. I do think that he's going – like, I remember one time, you know, Ken, Lou Lamoriello interviewing him about his philosophy, and he said, when you think you're good enough, you go for it. If you don't think you're good enough, you don't go for it. Well, I think these Islanders are pretty good, and I think he thinks they're pretty good too. So two names that jump out to me are a guy that you watch a lot, Kyle Palmieri, and the other guy that jumps out to me is Taylor Hall, because I think the Islanders tried to see last offseason if there was any way they could fit him. I'm sure there's more, and knowing Lou Lamoriello, he might not trade for either player now because I've mentioned them, but the fact is that I do think those are two of the types of guys that would be on his radar.
Up, Elliotte, on Taylor Hall, which sort of brings us back to the Sabres a little bit as well. What would Taylor Hall cost at this point based on what he's done or hasn't done to this point in the season, and the fact that he is a rental player?
You know, Jackie, I think the thing about that right now is there aren't a lot of buyers. And this is a buyer's market, and the sellers are really trying their best to drive up prices, and it's hard. Like Ekholm, I think the price is high because I think he's probably the best or most impactful player available. Number one, it's going to come down to how many teams are interested in Hall. First of all, does Hall stay in Buffalo? Yeah. Does he re-sign? Or how much interest is there on him? That's going to determine it. Number two, you have a board up there that says something very key. He's on an $8 million salary or a prorated $8 million salary this year. How are the Islanders or anyone else going to do that? Are the Sabres going to have to eat some of the contract? Are they going to have to take another contract back? That could increase the price too. So I think it just depends on how much interest there is and what kind of market you've got to determine that.
Elliot, I'll ask you about one of the guys that his name will come up because it's going to come up for a lot of coaching jobs, Mike Babcock. I mean, I know he's been doing interviews and it seems like he's trying to maybe rehabilitate his image a bit at this point. But where do you see him in some of these discussions when you think about the Buffalo Sabres coaching job? Because remember, as you know, I mean, they tried to hire him several years back. He opted to go to Toronto. Is he a candidate that they would consider?
You know, I don't know. And here's the reason. And I haven't had a chance to ask anybody in Buffalo this, but it happened several years ago. And as you mentioned, he was close to being the Sabres head coach. As a matter of fact, the Sabres thought they got him and he changed his mind and went to Toronto. And Toronto that day was about to hire Guy Boucher and Babcock called them and said, I'm going to take this job. So it was close. Now, I've had people tell me in Buffalo that they would never go down that road again, that they felt kind of jilted at the altar, and they said that they're not going to do that again in the future. So my guess, unless feelings have changed, would be that he would not be a contender in Buffalo. And that would be my feeling on the issue unless it's changed.
I remember that day in Toronto very well, Elliot. I was still in TO during that hiring, and it was a crazy day to be in the newsroom at Sportsnet when that all went down. It is St. Patrick's Day. You're not wearing green, but I got to hype up your threads for a second. I'm assuming that's a Deb Berman special.
Number one, Jackie, Toronto has never been the same since you left. And number two, this is a Deb Berman special. And that's why, and as you know, Deb Berman is the true MVP of Sportsnet. And all of this, or wrong hand, all of this behind me is her work.
Oh, she really is the best. Send her my best because I do miss working with her. And I appreciate what I assume is a bit of a sarcastic comment about my departure from Toronto.
It's not sarcastic at all. It's all the truth.
Elliot.